Respected senior members and friends, it is always a privilege to be with all of you. I have learned many, many things from this forum. I thank the institutions I work. The entire completed credit goes to Professor Padmachan Shivan. Salutation to God Almighty. January 2013, 18-year-old female, loss of weight 10 kilograms, evening rise of temperature, interrupted fever, no shivering or varicose. Headache global, more over biparietal and bifrontal regions, associated with vomiting. Headache, no relationship to fever. Took to religious worship. They went and prayed, and then fasting and diet restriction were advised. It led to the accentuation of the weight loss. Minimal cough, no sputum, no hemoptysis, no voice change, no dysphagia, no chest pain. Thin built, 90-60, no physical signs on chest, heart normal, no chronic sign, no neck rigidity, tachycardia, pulse rate was 140. Hemoglobin slightly on the lower side, perhaps normal for woman. ESR is raised, 30 and 65. Renal parameters normal, HIV negative. Man thought 12 millimeter, Vidal negative. X-ray just showed a biliary mottling throughout the lungs. Of course, here it is taken from many, many small mottlings are there. In the real-time X-rays, if you see, it is much more clearly evident. Here definitely comes the use of computer-aided X-ray film, which definitely will show the things better. Then because of the headache, two things were done. One, CT paranasal sinuses showed the S-shaped deviation of bony nasal septum, bilateral maxillary ethmoidal sinuses. Because I am not very competent, I will request Dr. Venkatesai to interpret these pictures. Then we went on to the taking the CT brain, showed a ill-defined enhancing lesions in the left cerebral hemispheres. Ill-defined hypodensities in the right cerebral hemispheres. Hydrocephalus, bilateral diffuse cerebral edema. May I request Professor Venkatesai to give the interpretations.
CNS. CT. CT PNS.
No, for now, we have it.
Some of the sections are the axial sections of the CT paranasal sinuses, which is included. These are all the ethmoidal sinuses. Here you can see this black one and all the axials, and the white one and all is the some of these are all the brain tissue, and this area is the sinusitis, because of the sinusitis. And this coronal section, you can see that the thickening, mucosal thickening is there, and the nasal septum deviation is seen here. This nasal septum deviation is seen here, and the mucosal thickening is seen here. That is the middle turbinate. This is hypertrophied middle turbinate is there. Yeah, this is the nasal septum. Center one is the nasal bony part of the septum, and the septum, this soft tissue part is there. And these two are the maxillary sinus. So maxillary sinuses are normal. This same in coronal sections. Next. Here you see what you are seeing is the posteriorly the cerebellum. This is the fourth ventricle, and this is the contrast one. So the contrast is seen here, and this is the circle of bilis, middle cerebral artery, anterior cerebral artery, and this is the temporal horn of the lateral ventricles. These two are the temporal horns. And this one is the third ventricle is seen here. Third ventricle is dilated. And here the frontal, parietal and the occipital lobes of the brain is seen here. And here you can see a multiple ring enhancing lesions in the cerebellum. You can see they have zoomed it here that the multiple ring enhancing lesions are seen in the cerebellum. Same curve. This is the plain CT. That is contrast CT. This is the plain CT.
Then I started on the seven drugs, six drugs, I didn't want to take any chance. Levofloxacin daily 500 milligrams, streptomycin 900 milligrams, because our body weight is less, I chose 0.5 gram, 300 milligrams, rifampicin, INS 600, rifampicin 450, ethambutol chose only 800 and pyrazamine 1 gram. Then I also put on steroids on this reducing dosages, 80, 60, 40, 20, 10 every week. Now, the case is presented for 2-3 reasons. One, here at time, we used to talk about the timetable of tuberculosis. That is, if it is going to be this week from the primary infection, because primary infection is one that we cannot determine the exact date, 3 to 6 months, you get the meningeal, miliary and pleural diseases. Up to 3 years, gastrointestinal bone, and then 3 years onwards, you can have reactivation and fibrotic disease. Now, this timetable was applicable in this lady. 3 to 6 months, she developed the meningeal, miliary lesion. The other thing that has been presented, systemic presentations of extrapulmonary diseases. Now, it can be seen extensively, many physical signs related to various parts of the involvement of the body by the Mycobacterium tuberculosis. But if you see, none of them are very specific for any lesion. But still, it is worthwhile because patient wants these things to subside. He is not bothered about 5 tests, 4 drugs, or resistance, or multi-drug resistance, single drug resistance. He is only interested, all the symptoms should disappear. Now, the third reason I presented this was, now with the development of this CT, the CSF analysis has taken a backdrop. Nobody is now very fond of doing CSF for the very simple fear reason that I felt in this case I should go in for a CSF analysis, but was refused by the patient, because patients are all internet friendly nowadays. Then I got it down, written down by a relative and a non-relative. I was very careful, wrote it down that CSF analysis has been denied by the patient, one relative and non-relative. Because whatever said and done, to see a pleocytosis of lymphocyte in the CSF and also see the protein rise and then wait for a day, see the Cobweb, and do the AFB stain in the Cobweb, still today stands as a better diagnostic gauge in the diagnosis of meningeal tuberculosis. But anyway, proof of the pudding is the eating. Patient has done very well. She has regained the thing. And another lesson in this take-home message is, 2 areas of tuberculosis, you start treatment and withdraw if you prove it's not tuberculosis. One is meningeal, second is bone. These are the 2 areas because of the subsequent consequences of the non-bacterial consequences, vasculitis, microinfarct, in bone tuberculosis, compression of the spine, paraplegia. Because of the non-bacterial consequences, these 2 areas, start the treatment, even if you fail to prove the diagnosis, we try it subsequently. For this reason, I thought, I share my experience. And also another thing, unfortunately, today in India, the non-allopathic forms of treatment, either in the form of prayer, in the form of other forms, still stands number one. They go there first, then only come to you next. Anyway, at least they have come. I am very happy about it. Thank you.
Any questions?
Sir, recently I have a patient, known patient, as a tuberculosis, who developed allergic to ethambutol and to pyrazina. And we are giving only INS and rifampicin. Are we justified or is there any form?
Whenever, sir, you get this type of allergy, I will tell what I follow, then I will answer specifically your question. I stop all the drugs and introduce every drug, wait for 48 hours. Introduce the next drug, wait for 48 hours. So the patient in the hurry 24 hours. So that with a matter of 15 days, you will be able to know. You have already done it and you have put an allergy. But do among the 5 primary drugs, streptomycin, INS, rifampicin, pyrazamine, ethambutol, you are eliminating the major drugs. Therefore, the regimen, what you are left with the non-allergic drugs is not sufficient. You may have to add ethinamide or prothionamide. You may have to add today among the pinolins, levofloxacin is accepted one, 500 milligram daily. It has to be added and if need be, some of the other drugs also should be added, sir. These are the suitable cases for institutional treatment.
So you prefer levofloxacin or megafloxacin?
I still continue with levofloxacin. Earlier I was doing ofloxacin. I now continue levofloxacin. Maybe Dr. Professor Shanmugam, do you have any comments on this, sir?
He is sitting from the levofloxacin is considered to be the pulmonary specimen for tuberculosis.
Respiratory infection and tuberculosis.
But levofloxacin can be given in the morning because it produces a lot of insomnia.
Yes. No. I'll correct, sir. As another thing, of course, as we discussed in RNTCP, I follow the DOT regime because my patients have to be linked to the National Tuberculosis Control Program, and we will start daily and then changing on to DOT become difficult. When you give the DOT, sir, I strongly believe, I repeat it again, against the direction of the national direction, I give the drugs in split timings. DOT people come home, put everything in the mouth, shabda, because her duty is over, she goes away. I don't do that. For morning, definitely, if I am present, because just we give an empty stomach. Then give 2 hours, 2 hours, and continue within the daytime all the other drugs. So that produces less vomiting.
Yes, sir.